Welcome to the Designing for Wildfires training series presented by the Federal Emergency Management Agency's Building Science Disaster Support Program. This is module one of a five-part series by the Marshall Fire Mitigation Assessment Team, or MAT, and serves as an introduction to the series. My name is Stacy Wright, and I'll be guiding you through this first module in the series.
FEMA's Building Science Disaster Support Program, or BSDS, provides building science technical support for disaster recovery operations to an array of stakeholders at the local, state, federal, tribal, and territorial levels. Following major disasters, the BSDS program sometimes deploys a team of subject matter experts known as the Mitigation Assessment Team, or MAT, to perform the work of BSDS and assess building performance. The MAT looks at building performance through an architecture and engineering lens, and evaluates how buildings performed during a natural hazard event to understand what worked and what failed. This information can inform recovery, rebuilding, and hazard mitigation, as well as support enhanced design, codes, and standards that can improve building performance in the future. This training series was created by the MAT that studied the Marshall Fire in Colorado. In this training series, the MAT hopes to expand knowledge of wildfire vulnerabilities in the built environment at different scales, from the community and neighborhood level to the subdivision and individual lot scales, and discuss resources and best practices.
This training series includes five modules. Following this introductory module, subsequent modules will focus on community planning, wildland-urban interface, or WUI, codes and standards, building level considerations, and defensible space. Module 2, discussing community planning concepts, is made up of two parts.
One important concept for this series is understanding the wildland-urban interface, or WUI. The WUI is the line, area, or zone where structures and other human development meet or intermingle with undeveloped wildland or vegetation fuels. This graphic illustrates the range of WUI conditions and associated terminology where wildlands and the built environment intermingle. As this continuum moves from the natural environment to urban town centers, the associated wildfire hazards and risks posed to structures and people inherently shift and thus necessitate different strategies to reduce these risks. The public perception of wildfire and wildfire risk often differs from the accepted definitions understood by experts. A wildland includes a range of environments and is not limited to forests and mountainous areas or tree stands in the foothills. It also includes shrublands and grasslands that can abut moderate to densely populated areas. Some attempts have been made to make distinctions. For example, the terms interface versus intermix versus occluded in the WUI definition published in the Federal Register on January 4, 2001. Interface is a community where structures directly abut wildland fuels. The intermix is an area where structures are scattered throughout a wildland area. An occluded community is one where structures abut an island of wildland fuels, such as a park or an open space. But these definitions have not been broadly communicated or well understood by the general public. Fundamentally, three ingredients are necessary for wildfires to occur, also known as the ignition triangle: oxygen, which starts and sustains combustion; heat, that raises the fuel temperature or simply heats fuel to its ignition point; and fuel, which sustains and carries flames. Eliminating or reducing one or more of those components is the basis of fire mitigation and suppression techniques. Wildfires, however, are more complex and challenging than the ignition triangle. The nature of the wildfire problem is a product of natural and/or man-made ignition sources, vegetative fuels, topography, weather, and characteristics of the built environment, such as building typologies, urban fuel loads, and density. Understanding how these factors interact, along with fire history, fire ecology, climatology, and human interactions with these various facets, is central to developing appropriate and effective mitigation strategies. Now let's talk more specifically about the Marshall Fire itself. The Marshall Fire was the most destructive wildfire incident in Colorado history. Approximately 6,000 acres were burned, over 1,000 buildings destroyed, and it resulted in over $500 million in damages. It was a wind-driven wildfire that started on the morning of December 30th, 2021, in Boulder County, Colorado. The fire quickly spread to the town of Superior and later to unincorporated Boulder County and the city of Louisville due to high winds gusting up to 115 miles per hour. By the next day, the winds died down and the heavy snow extinguished the fire. This fire was unique in that it originated in grasslands and flatlands near a heavily populated area and traditional suburban developments. As you can see in this timeline, the Marshall Fire moved quickly due to the high winds and presented several challenges for evacuation and firefighting efforts. In the early hours of the fire, high wind conditions severely limited early suppression operations. During the fire, many firefighting decisions had to be made on the fly as conditions changed rapidly. Due to the scale and severity of the fire, intense wind conditions, and constrained firefighter resources, structure triaging was considered necessary for the safety of firefighter personnel and to increase the likelihood of structure defense where efforts would be considered the most effective. The Marshall Fire was primarily a fast-moving grassland fire that was exacerbated by a combination of factors, including extreme winds, dry vegetation from a long-term drought, and unseasonably high temperatures for the area. It occurred in areas that at the time had not implemented best practices for the WUI code adoption and planning. FEMA's BSDS program saw this event as an opportunity to deploy its first wildfire mat and investigate the interactions between this wildfire and the built environment. The mat's findings better inform wildfire resiliency planning and implementation for planners, developers, government officials, and the public at large. The Marshall Fire Mat was a collaborative, multidisciplinary effort involving a range of public, private, and academic partners, such as FEMA, the U.S. Fire Administration, the State of Colorado, contracting support from STAR2, the Insurance Institute for Business and Home Safety, the International Code Council, Oregon State University, and UC Boulder. During the Marshall Fire Mat's deployment and data analysis, many observations were made and are detailed in the Mat's report. I'd like to mention a few of the key observations, as these concepts will be covered in more detail in other modules. First, the MAT noted that housing density and separations had an impact on structure-to-structure fire spread. For typical parcel sizes and residential structure separations like 5 to 10 feet, the effects of radiation, direct flaming, and ember exposures from a home on fire are likely sufficient to ignite an adjacent structure, particularly under high wind conditions. Second, natural hazard events can contribute to other key fire hazard conditions that can cause wildfires to ignite and spread. Development strategies in the WUI may not adequately address mitigation best practices or may inadvertently exacerbate the effects of multi-hazard events. Third, the location and vegetative makeup of open spaces within and adjacent to a development can increase risk of wildfire intensity and spread at the WUI and provide pathways for fire. Common spaces, green belts, and other types of open spaces can lead to high-risk vegetative conditions like non-fire adaptive plants, high fuel load due to the presence of creek beds or other water features, lack of fuel management, more flammable vegetation types, proximity to structures which, in combination with high fire hazard topographic features like slopes or drainage channels, can further intensify, intermix, and interface wildfire hazards and risks. Continuing with key observations from the Marshall Fire Mat, the Mat also observed that parcel-level vegetation management, or lack thereof, influenced the fire's impact to the structures. Vegetation near vents, exterior stairs, overhanging roofs and balconies, fences, and other places within 5 feet of a structure contributes to the fire risk. The Mat also noted that non-structural combustible attachments such as wood decks, fences, and outbuildings, and other vegetative debris that accumulates under or on these structures acted as wicks, helping the fire move. Flames can travel horizontally along combustible fences when ignited, spreading fire to the house itself. A lack of ember protection for vents was also noted in attics, crawl spaces, basements, and soffits. In wildfire conditions, these openings can provide an entrance for embers and hot gases to be blown or pulled into the house, which can result in the ignition of interior contents. Based on the observations found in the field, as well as the latest thinking in wildfire resiliency planning and risk mitigation, the MAT structured their findings and design recommendations into three main parts based on the different spatial scales of application: the community scale, the neighborhood or subdivision scale, and the individual lot scale, which includes buildings. The recommendations in the MAT report are also structured this way because it's important for us to think of wildfire resiliency not only at the building scale, but also at these larger scales. This is because fire safety features, whether present or absent at the neighborhood or community scales, or characteristics of the neighborhood or services provided at the community level, are all interrelated and can have a major influence on achieving desired fire performance at the building level, and vice versa. The Marshall Fire Map produced a detailed report outlining observations, conclusions, and recommendations that you may want to review. The Marshall Fire Map also produced multiple documents in addition to the MAT report, including mitigation recommendations for multi-hazard events, defensible space, structure ignition, detailing and joints, subdivision planning, and structure-to-structure fire spread. All of these documents can be found on FEMA's website and are useful resources to learn more about best practices. They also include links to other helpful resources and references.
That wraps up Module 1 of the Designing for Wildfires training series, presented by the Marshall Fire Map. Next in the series is Module 2, focusing on community planning, and has two parts. On behalf of FEMA's Building Science Disaster Support Program, thank you for taking the time to review this module.